Penguin Random House Audio presents Places and Names on War, Revolution, and Returning. This is the author, Elliot Ackerman. For Chewie. In the story of Patroclus, no one survives, not even Achilles, who was nearly a god. Patroclus resembled him. They wore the same armor. Always in these friendships, one serves the other. One is less than the other. The hierarchy is always apparent, though the legends cannot be trusted. Their source is the survivor, the one who has been abandoned. What were the Greek ships on fire compared to this loss? In his tent, Achilles grieved with his whole being, and the gods saw he was a man already dead, a victim of the part that loved, the part that was mortal. The Triumph of Achilles, Louise Gluck. The revolution is over, or the music will live forever. Azaz, Killis. Prologue. Crowds in the streets, marches, songs. Those are finished now. The revolution is over. The war can begin. A column of smoke boils upward from Azaz, a hamlet along Syria's northern border with Turkey. Beneath the blanket of slate clouds, the whip crack of rifle fire comes at odd intervals. The Islamic State battles the northern storm, a brigade of the dissolving Free Syrian Army. The air is still, no wind. The smoke continues to climb, perfectly straight, building like an obelisk, a monument. Azaz's sister town is Killis, a backwater tucked among the mossy low hills of Turkey's southern border. Just after sunrise, a week ago, the journalist Stephen Sotloff crossed here. That same afternoon, he disappeared on the road to Aleppo. A year later, the Islamic State will behead him. Today, that group's name means nothing. They are virtually unknown. Today, a revolution is ending. All I know is I have come to be close to something familiar. Standing along the roadside in Killis, just next to the border crossing, everything is confusion. Confusion in suitcases. The morning's refugees don't know what to do with themselves, so they move their suitcases from one side of the road to the other. They stack them by the bus stop, a single bench beneath an overhang, a schedule tacked to its side. They read the schedule. It has no meaning. The buses don't come. They glance at their watches, checking the time, which also has no meaning. The hour and minute hands will never point out the answer of how long they must wait. A column of halted 16-wheelers also waits, stalled at the border. The cargo can go no further, but it can't go back. Confusion is suitcases. Confusion is halted 16-wheelers. Confusion is waiting. Farther from the road, where the morning's refugees have yet to venture, there is a camp. Behind a chain-link fence, tents are neatly aligned, and between their rows, children play simple games, hide-and-seek, hopscotch, tag, and women watch. The men pass quickly from one tent to another, staring at the ground, hiding their faces as if hiding all they've lost. Outside the camp's entrance, a steel revolving door, the same as a subway turnstile, an entrepreneurial Turk has built a cafe. It is simple. Plastic chairs and tables, a propane stove for tea, a refrigerator for bottled water and soda, some packaged foods, potato chips and chocolates. My companion on this trip, and for many months to follow, is Matt, a friend of a friend, who has spent the last 6 years living in northern Iraq and in downtown Kabul, teaching at the American University in both places. At the cafe, he orders a pot of tea and a plate of refreshments. Matt's purpose at the border is more practical than mine. He wants to see if it is open. Only the week before, he incorporated the Syrian Research and Evaluation Organization, or SREO, or, as he says it, SREO, a startup that will bid on contracts from international organizations auditing their humanitarian relief programs or subcontracting their excess work. A boom of aid has flooded into this conflict, and that parallel economy gives Matt his ticket to ride. One at a time, a cluster of men gathers around Matt, who comes to his feet, offering his hand and stopping the conversation to welcome each who joins this group. Matt rode heavyweight crew at Boston University. His arms are enormous. No one stands taller than his chin, which is covered with a full, blonde beard. His eyes are blue. When I come over, no one stands. I sit among the refugees and Matt. Our conversation is in Arabic, Turkish, broken English. We wrestle with language as we wrestle with our topic. Why would two rebel groups, the Islamic State and the Free Syrian Army, fight one another? Wasn't the revolution about toppling President Bashar al-Assad? What is happening in Azaz? What has happened? The revolution is over. The war is beginning. The men tell us what we already know about the fighting, about the politics. We stare at them as if we might read their histories, the ones we want to understand, the ones they won't likely share in their faces, which express themselves mainly with anger, sadness, and occasionally humor when explaining some misfortune that pierces the frontier between tragedy and comedy. We watch so closely that we don't drink our tea and we don't eat our food. And when they all stand, we are startled. Our eyes follow theirs, and we see someone stumbling toward us. He is young, in his 20s, and he walks like a man in need of a cane. He wears a black parka that is too heavy for an autumn day. His cheeks are hollow, his complexion tinged a poisonous green, a film of sickness trapped beneath his skin. His gaze rests on our group. He comes closer. His eyes fix on Matt's, shifting to mine. They are bloodshot, a starburst of veins. The group moves aside, allowing him to step in front of us, the pair of Americans. He unzips his parka. Lifting his t-shirt, he winces at the pain. From sternum to waistband, he has been flayed open. His scar runs straight as a rail track, and the holes of heavy, unthreaded stitches appear industrial, binding like steel ties. We'd search the expressions of these other men for some knowledge of this place, one beyond politics and the meaningless movements of armies, but this young man with a serrated scar wears such knowledge across his stomach. So much so that what I might learn from his words seems incidental compared with what I might learn from looking at his body. He pins his shirt up with his chin, tracing the length of his scar with the nubs of his index fingers, both of which have been snipped off. He is from Aleppo. He worked in a sugar refinery that was bombed during a regime offensive. This explains the scar. His amputated fingers remain a mystery. His six-year-old daughter was killed in the same offensive, at home with her mother. But he doesn't tell me this. Another man whispers it in my ear. Unconscious after the bombing, he was taken to a hospital, which, once the regime advanced, fell into their territory. Flitting in and out of consciousness, he waited in the hospital for a surgeon, or death. For days he waited. There was a counteroffensive. Then the Daesh took the hospital, he says. Incomprehension must read across my face because a man, the same one who explained about his dead daughter and wife, points across the border, to the smoke, and he explains that Daesh is the Arabic enunciation of the acronym ISIS, al-Dawla al-Islamiyya al-Iraq al-Sham. Because I was in a hospital held by the regime, continues the man with the missing fingers, the Daesh assumed that I supported Assad. They believe that to pray to Mecca, one needs fingers to point the way. If the soul wanders, they disfigure the body as they believe the soul has already been disfigured, removing the index fingers so you cannot pray. What miracle has brought him here, enabling his escape to the relative safety of this place, Matt asks, but no answer is given, and the man pulls down his t-shirt. It is purple, with bold yellow letters printed across it, a proclamation in English. The music will live forever. Some gawas are set on the table, and everyone takes from the same pack. The Syrians smoke aggressively, lighting one after another, as if by smoking their lives away, they exercise some control over them. The conversation returns to the war strategy, the ever-shifting front lines, the seasons of offensive and counteroffensive, Matt scribbles in a notebook, alternating his stare between the pages, the men, and the distant border. Matt hadn't fought in Iraq and Afghanistan as I had, but we've been affected in much the same way, as evidenced by the fact we've journeyed here, for a litany of reasons, but none greater than to take a look at another war. What we see across the border, in Azaz, is familiar enough. An urban battle waged in this part of the world, but we watch in a different context. This isn't our war. The looks we take seem to be looks back, as if, watching the fight ahead of us, we might understand the one behind us, the violence we'd witnessed in the last decade. Our conversation is interrupted when the steel turnstile from the camp clangs open. Another man, blonde-haired and blue-eyed as Matt, strides toward us. His complexion is ruddy, his fair skin burnt a bright even red from time in the sun. His camouflage army pants are of a Russian pattern, and holstered to his leg is a medical kit. Everyone stands, even the man with the scar.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.